So we are happy to be here to share with you our experience in using trigger action programming for personalizing the behavior of humanoid robot. And this is joint work with Nicola Leonardi, who was a master's student in the digital humanities degree at the University of Pisa, and Marco Manca and Carmen Santoro, who are here somewhere in the room. So let's say that at some point we had some monies, and we decided to buy a humanoid robot. It was expensive, it was 16,000 euros, at least for us, was an expensive toy. But I mean, it was really interesting to see how much interest this kind of technology can raise from any type of users, ranging from children to older adults. So we said, oh, this is really nice and interesting. And we all see that robots are increasingly used in many types of context. Robot is a quite general term, so we probably need to distinguish a little bit. For example, there are industrial robots, which usually are used in a specific context for doing specific tasks, such as picking an object and move somewhere. And social humanoid robots, which have this feature to be able to interact by using human-like modalities. And they can really be deployed in any type of context for housework, supporting elderly, disabled people, hospital, and so on. One interesting issue that comes at this point is that, I mean, since they can really be used in many possible contexts, it's really hard for developers to predict all such possible use, to predict all the possible needs. So we think that a key challenge with such robots is to allow the customization in order to, address all the specific, situated, often evolving user needs. And so we think that if we even allow the end users to directly decide how they should behave for their specific needs, this solution would be really high impact. So let's say that, generally speaking, we are interested in end-user development, which concerns meta tools that allow people without programming experience to be able to directly create or modify their application. And on the other hand, all the robots can be programmed, but they usually have languages that are really targeting engineers. There are some efforts. There have been some efforts in order to simplify the development of a robot application. So, for example, Choreograph is a icon data flow visual language where we have some icons associated with some set of functionalities that people can compose. I remember last guy, Wentrop, presented a paper which was about using a block-based language for supporting industrial robots. But as I said, this kind of robots, usually they have specific tasks to perform, so they like a limited set of options that should be supported, while modern humanoid robots, they really have a wide variety of possible interactions, possible actions that they can perform. So let's say we thought about the trigger action programming. Why? Because we think, okay, this compass structure where you have just to indicate the specific situation that are relevant for you and the desired feedback is something that even people without an algorithmic ability can think of, can really use for specifying their needs. And so they don't need to learn a complex programming structure. And actually, I mean, some trigger action programming is already used for automation of web services. So probably the most common environment is IFTTT, where you can connect existing services such as Facebook, Dropbox, and so on. So you can say, if someone tags me on Facebook, then please turn my light on the office a specific color, for example. And so we wanted to investigate, can this paradigm be applied to support personalization of humanoid robots? And another interesting challenge is, can we exploit this paradigm to connect the behavior of the robot with what happens in the surrounding environment? So let's say that in order to address such challenges, we have a language where we can distinguish between events and conditions, because events are when something really changes, and conditions are specific states that can be true for some time. And then, of course, it's possible to define various types of actions. So we can say, when I look like sad, then the robot should tell me some joke. Or When someone arrives at the door, the robot should go there and say, oh, who are you? What do you want? Things like that. It's easy to specify. So let's say that we have such humanoid robots, we have a lot of sensors, smart objects, and so on, and we have already some software that developers have created and made available for, you know, controlling the behavior of the robot. And then arrives the end user. The end user has specific needs, they want to change something, and so we provide this tailoring environment where it can indicate the specific personalization rules, and such rules are sent to a role manager, which subscribes to a middleware, we call it a context manager, that is able to receive the events from the robot and the surrounding environment. So it has what we call a context delegate associated with the robot, which is a kind of intermediate level between the low-level events and the events that can be specified by a person without programming experience. And so when the relevant triggers occur, then it can activate the desired behavior, the desired actions, and so on. So this is the robot that we have used for our research. So it's by SoftBank Robots, it's 1.2 meter tall. It has really reach of tactile sensors, laser sensors, it has four microphones, two RGB cameras, and can really perform the typical human-like modalities of interaction. Speech, gesture, can follow with the gaze someone who is nearby, detect proxemics, and so on. And so this is a simple environment that we propose to people without programming experience in order to specify their trigger. I mean, so they are classified according to different categories, and the selected elements are highlighted, and when they select the events associated with the robot, they are classified depending on the type of event, whether they are related to touching something or they are related to recognizing some aspect that happens nearby. And we also give the possibility, of course, to compose such trigger and such action. So, for example, if you look at IFTTT, it only supports single trigger rules, while for robots, it becomes important to be able to specify some more structured behavior. So it's possible to indicate logical operators for composing triggers and to indicate whether actions should be executed in parallel or in sequence. And then another interesting point is that we can have also a kind of connection, a kind of continuum between what happens in the environment and what happens with the robot. So it's possible also to specify triggers that are related to events of objects that are nearby, so for example, lights, heating system, oven, fridge, and so on. So we can connect these two worlds. So we can say when a person enters a room and the light is off, then please the robot should greet the person and then the light should change, should be on it to a specific color. So just to give an idea about how it works. And so this is the environment. So it's really target people who don't know any programming language. So they can start, follow this categorization of possible trigger. Then, of course, in this case, we are interested in the robot, the pepper. So they say, well, if there is a recognized face and is someone that the robot does not know, and this person says, oh, what is this lab about? Then the possible action are, okay, play an excited animation, synthesize a welcome message, show on the screen some information concerning the laboratory, and or say something about such a laboratory. So, I mean, it really takes a very short time to create this specific rule, so people then they can save, provide a name, they can share the rule with other people, and then, of course, they can execute it.
Hi.
Hi.
What is lab about?
Welcome, visitor. This is the Human-Computer Interaction Lab. Our research activity is in methods and tools to support user interface designers, software developers, and end users in obtaining systems that can be accessed from different contexts of use in such a way to improve usability, accessibility, and user experience.
Fine, thanks. Bye-bye.
So you see, it really takes a short time to create it and it can be immediately executed. So we can have another example. In this case, the person is known and asks, oh, what's my agenda today?
Hi, Pepper.
Hi.
What's my agenda today?
Hi, Alex. Here is your agenda. At 12 o'clock, you have to attend to a seminar about website usability in Rumor 27. The speaker is Jacob Nielsen. At 3 p.m., there is the SmartGIS Project General Meeting in Room C9.
So, I mean, as you can see, it's easy to create, it's easy to execute, to see what the resulting behavior should be. So we said, okay, let's try a first user test. Of course, we involve people who are not professional developers, people who don't have any computer science degree. So in the end, we found, you know, in the administration offices, people who were really useful for this type of task and test. And we got 17 people, they had various educational levels, and so the test was done in the laboratory, and it was organized in various parts. So first we asked them to indicate what rules would you like in general to specify to a similar robot. Then we asked them to specify rules with increasing complexity, so which means one trigger, one action, two triggers, one action, two triggers, two actions. And then we gave them some natural language description of some rules and asked them, okay, please use the tool to specify such rules and execute them and see whether, you know, the resulting behavior is really what you expected. So let's say that they were able to do it. I mean, they did not perform any particular significant error. Also, in terms of time, I mean, it did not take a particularly long time to create such rules. I mean, there was a bit long at the first time because it was also the first time that they used this rule editor, so they also took that opportunity in order to familiarize a little bit with this environment, and they filled in a SUSE questionnaire, which was positive. And then, of course, we asked them, did the robot perform as you expected? In general, yes, there was some, let's say, minor issue with speech recognition because sometimes, you know, we know that it always not work as it is expected. And also in terms of performance, in general, was okay, but in some cases they were expecting, you know, some more prompt reaction from the robot, while, of course, the robot is a complex system. In some cases, it takes some time before performing the desired behavior. But in general, I mean, the experience seemed to be positive. So let's say that if we want to just comment a little bit in more general terms from this experience, what we can say is that one key issue is to offer the most appropriate abstraction level. Because, you know, programming a robot can be done at very many, many levels. It can range from low-level hardware primitives to high-level social behavior. And of course, on the one end, we want to provide the possibility to specify rules using concepts that people understand. On the other hand, we want also to allow them to control, to have more control on what can happen. So this implies some more, you know, technical description. Then, I mean, let's say that this type of approach for humanoid robot is different with respect to what happens with IoT services, where usually we have smart objects which have quite a simple behavior, a few properties and so on. The robot is really a complex system. It can do many things. So it becomes important to provide a little bit more structure in specifying the possible action. We think that this opportunity to create a continuum between robot behavior and what happens nearby is really open up a lot of new services that can be exploited in many application domains. Of course, I mean, there is the issue that sometimes what people specify is not exactly what they would like to get, I mean, would not obtain. And so maybe some more support for simulating the rule execution or to understand when some rules are in conflict would be useful. There are cases in which the robot does not exactly behave as it expected because, for example, there is low connectivity and so on. So in order to avoid frustration from the user side, it's possible to make them aware that there is some temporary issue and so the robot performance is not as optimal as it would be expected. And of course, I mean, it's important in order to facilitate this creation of personalization rules to allow people to share rules, to use previous rules to create new ones. This is something that can be particularly useful in this context. So they say that on one hand, I mean, our study demonstrated that this is an approach to physics. I mean, it's something that can work with people without a programming experience. But we are aware that this is just a first step along an interesting direction, because our test was in a laboratory. We gave them specific tasks to perform. So what we would like in the near future is to carry out some more, let's say, longitudinal validation, where in the wild people can use this environment, so that we can investigate to what extent it can be useful, how such personalization needs can be expressed, whether or not they evolve over time. So that would be something interesting that we plan to investigate soon.
Well, of course, Emilia Barakova, Eindhoven University of Technology, you know me. I want to ask what was the cyclomatic complexity of the programs they developed.
What type of...
Cyclomatic complexity means how many loops they implemented.
Okay, well, we gave them these three exercises. So let's say that... So they did not specify many, many rules. So in that case, I don't remember any particular case of loop. Of course, I mean, when people create rules in an extended manner, there are some issues that can occur. One is the possibility to create loops. But, I mean, I don't remember any particular loop when we did this. Also, probably because they did not specify, you know, many rules. I mean, so it was a limited set that targeted different types of behaviors, so there was not this particular issue.
Version one of our end-user development system was also something like, if something happens, something else will follow. But finally, we converged it to a dynamical system approach. When there is the whole behavior space is a dynamical system, is triggered of all possible sensory information.
Yeah.
So you can get more realistic behavior. For example, if something happens, for example, a person interacts with a robot but pushes down and the robot falls, or a robot is not able to perform some action, so the robot has to go back to the state when he can perform some interaction.
I see the point. Well, let's say that in this case we don't target the possibility to specify all the possible behaviors. So we really want to allow them to say, I would like this something more, you know, because such a robot, they arrive with already some basic behavior available and so on. But in some cases, they don't capture the specific need that people have. I mean, so what we would like to give the possibility is to say, I have this specific need, let me add, and so maybe, I can see that it would be interesting to do some study to compare different metaphors, different approaches to see what are, and probably when they are more effective. Because I don't see that one solution is always the best, of course.
It's not about best solution, but a possibility to allow a little bit more complex interaction.
Yeah. That's it depends also on the user and the knowledge of technical aspect, of course. Yeah.
Well, we want to work with end users who don't have technical knowledge, but yeah. How to allow these people to create a more complex behavior. This is the question.
That's an interesting challenge. Yeah.
We have time for one last question, if it's a short one. Not seeing any hands, we might wrap up. The next thing coming up on the schedule is the morning.